One Mic.
All I need is one mic.
What's the name of the show?
One Mic with Big Mike.
You know, ain't nobody getting hurt, anybody. You know, there's no crime being committed.
And they say his style is too urban for the radio.
This is real life stuff that's happened to me.
Well, you know what?
F you.
One Mic with Big Mike.
I like to be able to do what I want to do.
A sports talk show. But no subject matter is off limits.
Meek Mill's concert is not called the Hell Yeah, I Banged Khloe Kardashian concert.
And now, your host.
Put your hands together for the one, the only.
Big Mike.
What up, y'all? Welcome to the Hump Day edition of the One Mic. One Mic with Big Mike Show. I, of course, am your host, Big Mike. Had a little technical difficulty there starting the show off, man. This damn thing wouldn't connect to the damn internet. But I'm here, man. I'm here. Help you guys get on over the rest of that hump. Appreciate everybody for joining me. If this is your first time, welcome. If this has been multiple times for you, you must be a glutton for punishment, but I appreciate it all the same. I'm being heard via Spreaker.com. That's Spreaker.com. Also, via my website. Go to that. Check it out. www.onemicwithbigmike.com. You guys can go there as well as on Spreaker and join the live interactive chat room where you guys can interact with me during the show. Ask me questions. You guys can comment on things that I'm saying. You guys can talk amongst each other in the chat room. It's wide open, man. Just go to the either Spreaker or to the website. Once again, onemicwithbigmike.com. You'll see a little thought bubble dancing around on the streaming player. When you go to the website, you just use your Facebook login. Get on in there. You guys can be a part of the show as well. Also, you can hear the show if you don't get a chance to sit around and check out the entire situation. You can come back later and get it. Once again, via the website, via Spreaker, also, though, via iTunes, TuneIn. You can go to YouTube as well. I'm in all those places. My SoundCloud situation ain't really straight because I don't delete the old episodes like I should, and it doesn't do it automatically. So I just kind of let that be, you know, let it be what it is. This weekend is going to be, Memorial Day weekend, right? The unofficial start of the summer. Also today, it's my mom's birthday, so, you know, happy birthday to my mom. She's not listening because my family is barred from listening to the show. By the way, long story, don't worry about it. But yeah, today's my mom's birthday, man, the first woman I've ever loved, man. So, you know, I know she's having a good day today. She said she's just going to kick it and relax and whatnot. I told you guys on Monday, I was trying to set up something big for the day, and I wasn't going to say anything about it until... or when it actually went down. Well, it didn't go down. I was trying to get comedian Paul Mooney on the show today. And, you know, I got in contact with him. He put me in contact with his people, his manager, whatnot. Talked to his manager for like 40 minutes on Sunday, man. This dude was telling me the whole history of Paul Mooney, man. And told me to call him yesterday to set everything up. And, you know, I did the old call, text, even text today. No answer, man. No reply. So, as of right now, man, that situation, you know, and sometimes it happens, man. My show ain't the biggest deal yet. So, you know, somebody of that stature, you know, it's easy for them to kind of just give me the old Heisman, or their people to give me the old Heisman. So, it is what it is. We'll keep it moving. We'll see if we can get to the point where we can make that situation happen. Because honestly, that's somebody who I really wanted to talk to. Not even just because, like, his manager asked me if I'm just trying to get big name people on the show to improve the listenership. And I was like, yeah, but still, not at the expense of it being someone who I don't really care about talking to. You know what I mean? But I really wanted to talk to Paul Mooney, man, and get his perspective on a lot of things. He's not a sports guy. That was relayed to me plenty of times. He's not a sports guy. But you guys know more than anybody. I don't care, you know, at certain points in times, talking about sports ain't really the thing. You know, I want to talk about other things. Speaking of that, before I get into the show, before I get into setting up the show, I want to address something and just kind of get it out and just be done with it. Social media has a way of kind of, I think, sometimes forcing people into feeling that they should be outraged about something without giving it proper context. You know what I mean? You feel like that's the right thing to do because we're all supposed to be members of this cult of likability, meaning you can't really go outside of the masses and have your own thought process without being ridiculed. Me, of course, I don't care about that kind of stuff. And the things I say not to be contrarian, but because I mean them. And the thing that I want to talk about, Trayvon Martin, George Zimmerman in particular. Apparently, he's auctioned off the gun he used to kill the kid with. And people are outraged by it. Or people want you to believe that they're outraged about it. I myself, I'm not. And the reason why is because bad people doing bad things don't surprise me. You know what I'm saying? Like a douchebag dude doing something douchey, that's what you're supposed to do. It's like a dog barking. You know what I mean? It is what it is. That being what it is, like even if you are one of those people who are outraged about it or real mad about it, think about it this way. Now, I was talking to my wifey about this the other day. Think about it this way. I can't be more, and this is one of the things that got me very, like, I'm not a real emotional person, especially when it comes to like stuff that didn't directly affect me. But this is one of the things that really it affected me. The Trayvon Martin situation and the case itself, it really had an effect on me. And I'll say this, that the worst thing that George Zimmerman could have done, he already did it. He killed that boy in cold blood, man. He hunted him down like an animal and killed him in the street, man. So anything after that, like, I don't care. I mean, I don't care. The kid is gone, man. Like, if he went and just, you know, took a dump on his kid's grave, like, that stuff don't mean nothing to me. The worst thing you could have done is already done. There is no compounding it. Like, he didn't kill the kid again. He's dead, man. And all the people who are, like, posting it over and over and over again on your social media, man, all you're doing is giving exposure to somebody who don't deserve it, man. You know what I mean? Somebody who needs and requires it's required to be for him to be ignored at every turn by everybody. You know what I mean? And I feel I feel some kind of way talking about it right now, to be honest with you, man. To be even addressing it right now, I feel some kind of way. But I just felt like, you know, in the spirit of what I want my show to be about and the transparency that I want to bring to the table, I really felt the need to kind of just, you know, let that be known that, look, man, you don't have to be outraged by stupidity coming from stupid people. You should expect it. You know, be surprised when a stupid person does something, you know, smart, or a bad person does something good. Like, be surprised at that. Bad people doing bad things and douchebag people doing douchey things, that's par for the course, man. That's a cat meowing. It's supposed to do it. You know what I mean? Now that that's been said, let me get on to setting up the show. Now, today, the bottom of the hour, of course, we got to do our daily look back. When we don't have a guest at the bottom of the hour, we do a daily look back, and we call it on this day. I call it on this day. I'm so used to still saying we, like I'm in damn France. I call it on this day where I take a look back into the annals of sports and give you guys some historical tidbits that you can take with you, share with your folks in the barbershop and all those good things. Also, we got to talk about the Atlanta Falcons. The Atlanta Falcons have been awarded Super Bowl, I think it's LIII, the one in 2019. The Falcons have been, the Atlanta franchise has been awarded that Super Bowl. And I want to kind of get into a little conversation about some of the conversation that's surrounding that selection. Saw this thing the other day about Tony Gwynn. I think the other day, maybe yesterday, marks 2 years since he's been gone, since he passed on. And he died from cancer, which the people who love him and most people consider to be a side effect of him using smokeless tobacco, dip as they call it. And his family is now suing the tobacco industry. And I posted it on Facebook. You know, I just wanted to see what people thought about, you know, that going that route by the family. And I want to talk about that a little bit today. Also, let me just mention this real quick. Craig Sager, man, dude, cool dude. Craig Sager, sideline reporter for TNT. He's going to receive the Jimmy V Perseverance Award at the ESPYs this year, man, for his battle with cancer, man. If you don't know the story, man, this dude is going through, he's going through so much, man, to live. You feel me? I talked about this a few weeks ago. I have a very, very, very good understanding of what he's going through and what he's going through, man. And most people won't. You know, most people will understand it. Well, it's cancer and this type of stuff. Most people won't understand the type of treatments that he's going through, man, to be able to sustain life. You know what I mean? So, yeah. Big up to Craig Sager, man. I was watching this story on Showtime. Not Showtime. HBO's Real Sports. And it was tough, man. I'm not going to front. It was tough to watch it, man. So I wanted to make sure I mentioned that. Roger Goodell at the owners meeting in Chicago spoke on a couple of things. He spoke about Tom Brady very briefly, so I'm not going to really address that. But he also talked about the congressional report that came out that accused the NFL of trying to steer concussion research or CTE research to make sure they got the outcome that they wanted. Also in the NFL, a member of the NFL's top brass, the Bills GM, has some, you know, what he's calling after the fact a slip of the tongue, but I don't believe it is. And, you know, I had a conversation or a Facebook conversation with one of my buddies, Jake, today about what he said, and I'll get into all that later on. But he's basically talking about football as a sport and the unnatural nature of it, something that I've been telling people since I was playing. Like, I stopped playing football in, like, 99. That was my last year of college in 99. And I've been telling people about that. Football is probably the most unnatural of sports. So we'll get into that as well. And, of course, we got to talk NBA playoffs, man. Like, like, things are happening that, for all intents and purposes, really shouldn't be happening. From last night to, of course, Tuesday night, I wasn't here on Monday night. So I wasn't here on Tuesday to talk about what's going on with the Raptors and the Cavaliers series. So I'm going to start there. That's where I'm going to start today, right here on the One Mic with Big Mike show. Don't forget, tell a friend to tell a friend, man. You guys can check out the show via Spreaker. That's Spreaker.com. They also have an app for all of your mobile devices. Just sign up for your free Spreaker account and search for my show, One Mic with Big Mike, the number one, MicWithBigMike. That's the same thing for my website, OneMicWithBigMike.com. You guys can go there. The show is streaming live currently. And also, man, if you guys got anything to say, I don't take callers on the show, but, you know, I do have a live interactive chat room, so you guys can jump on in the chat room and, you know, bounce your ideas, bounce your thoughts, your opinions or whatnot off of me or off of each other within the chat room. Also, if you don't get a chance to stick around for the entire show, don't worry about that. Spreaker has me covered. My website also has the archived episodes. You can also, if you've got the iTunes app for all my Apple users, or if you got TuneIn on your mobile situation, by all means, man, you can go back later and check the show out. I found, man, that, you know, a lot of people, get the show later on, because that's the world we live in, right? We live in this on-demand world. You want it when you want it, instead of having to schedule time to watch TV shows or listen to radio situations or podcasts or whatnot. So that's how you acquire the show either after the fact. Now, to the playoffs, Monday evening. Sorry, not Tuesday. I said I had a guest on from Fox Sports, Yovan Buha, right? And I told him, like, look, before this Toronto-Cleveland series started, I said I believe that Toronto can win a game when they finally do. Well, they won one, so I had to up the stakes a little bit. I believe they can win two when they win two. Well, damn it, damn it, them damn Raptors won two. They won both games at home. And, of course, because of the sports world that we live in, something must be wrong with the Cavs. Now, things they've always been wrong with the Cavs. I talked about it even before the game. Defensively, they're deplorable. You know, and, you know, their deficiencies on defense have been covered up by shot making, which, you know, is the name of the game, basically, in basketball, is putting the ball in the hoop as many times as you can. And when you're doing that and you're doing it more prolifically from three, yeah, a lot of the other dumb stuff can be can be covered up. You know, bad rotations and guys, you know, giving up points at the rim and all this kind of stuff, that gets covered up. But what's happened, and this is what I asked Yovan about on Monday, it felt to me as though the Cavs just kind of got addicted to that hot shooting, not really being realistic with themselves, saying, you know what, this is something that is good now, but we haven't been doing this all year. And, you know, you can kind of attribute some of that to the acquisition of Channing Frye, but not all of it. You know, J.R. Smith losing his mind, which, by the way, I say this every year, man, about this dude. Well, not every year, but for the last 2 years that he's been with the Cavs, like, if you're resting and you're gauging your team's success on what J.R. does, you can't do that. He's too on and off, man. He's too hot and cold. When he's hot, he's blazing hot. When he's cold, he's ice cold. That can't be the measuring stick. And now we're seeing kind of like the residuals of that. You know, I saw an article today that talked about the Cavs actually still getting open shots, but they're not hitting them. That's a bigger problem. It's not even like Toronto is starting to do something different. These dudes are getting open shots, which open shots, based on the article, is defined as a defender not being within 4 feet of you. And I think that's reasonable for an NBA player, right? 4 feet? You might as well be out there shooting by yourself. So, yeah, I just really think that you couple the Cavs falling in love with the three-point shot and thinking that there's something that they're not, and or you couple it with the reemergence of Kyle Lowry, DeMar DeRozan, Bismack Biyombo, down low, killing, by the way, killing Tristan Thompson, to the point where, like, now that dude, like, you a lot of, like, I'm not really the dude that's going to always go to the money, but the reason I'm going to the money with Tristan Thompson is because he's one of the few players, the few people in the league that got paid to do basically one thing, man. You know what I mean? He don't score no points. They don't run no plays for him. You know what I mean? He can't get his own shot. He's not even that, you know, he's not a great defender, but he's a dude that takes care of your boards. And when your man shows up and kills you for 26 of them joints, yeah, man, it's real. You know, Kevin Love not in the ballgame in the fourth quarter. Like, Richard Jefferson been in the league like 91 years, man. He's getting fourth quarter minutes instead of Tristan Thompson. That can't be a thing, I don't think. You know what I mean? Like, it's cool. He hit the shots that he took. What was like 3 or 4 layups he got, and he hit them. But there's still that other side of the court where somebody's got to protect the paint. Kevin Love, another guy missing in action. People tweeting, "Where's Kevin Love?" You know, there was a convenient excuse kind of put in front of the Cavs when he stepped on the foot of the referee and kind of came up hobbling a little bit, but then Tyronn Lue, like, nah, he's good. Nah, he's all right. You know, I just didn't want to put him back in the game in that hostile environment. Wait, what? Yeah, dude. That can't be a thing. Like playing on the road can't be a deterrent to you putting a member of your quote unquote big three back into an Eastern Conference Finals game. Feel me? When you getting worked, like, they was down by like 18 points in the ball game. And, you know, they made a little comeback, and I'm watching and see, you know, how this is going to play out. LeBron, 46 minutes, man, in the ball game. You know what I mean? And someone brought up the point today in something I was reading, said, now, would we see that carryover in today's game? Now, they're going to play tonight. If you're listening live, they're going to play tonight in about another hour plus. And we're going to see if that all those minutes are going to have an effect on LeBron's legs. Maybe not in the first quarter, but as the game wears on. By the way, I'm still not picking the I'm sticking to my initial assessment of the series, and I'm only making these small but large addendums to them. I believe Toronto can win 3 games when they win 3 games. I gotta keep opening every time they win. Now, LeBron, speaking of all the minutes he played, you know, for whatever it's worth, he kind of played into the narrative that so many people have created around him in these fourth quarters. Didn't take a shot or didn't score a point in the last 5 minutes. And I think somebody said he didn't take a shot in the last 3 minutes. That's kind of problematic, man, when you're that dude. And now here's the other thing that's happening. Here's the other thing that's happening. People are starting to get real comfortable calling LeBron James the second best player on the planet. Like, look, we gotta go back. We gotta kind of calm down a little bit and understand what's happening. You know what I mean? We gotta understand what's happening. Steph Curry is the back-to-back MVP, meaning he's the most valuable player. He had good seasons, right? But as far as an overall basketball player, there still isn't one better than LeBron in the NBA. And if the NBA is the standard for the best basketball players in the world, thus he would still be the best basketball player in the world. Last year we had Bone Crusher, you know, attention Bone Crusher on the show following the finals. And his rationale last year, this wasn't even after the unanimous vote, MVP voting. He said that Steph Curry was the best player on the planet because he's the best player on now the best team. They had just won the championship. And, like, that's kind of – that rationale is kind of flawed to me. You know what I mean? Because with that rationale, that would mean at some point, like, Chauncey Billups was the best player on the planet. No one's ever thought that. And to further that point, saying that because you're the MVP – you're the best player on the planet. You know, like, Steve Nash has two of them, by the way. At one point, like, Steve Nash was a good player, but at no point was he ever the best player in the world. Kobe Bryant has one MVP. Kobe Bryant, after 20 years of doing Kobe-ish, one MVP. Come on, man. You know what I mean? It's like, we just got to understand what, again, I've had this conversation already, I know, but it seems to now be floating, you know, and then just very easily coming out of the mouths of people who should be smart. Tracy McGrady. Yeah, LeBron James, second best player in the league. Come on, man. You know what I mean? Come on, B. Nah. And then here's the thing I want to say. Before I get all into this OKC series, I want people to understand, man, the reason that I'm so adamant when I start talking about appreciating greatness, because it's fleeting. Look at what's going on with Steph Curry right now. And I'm not saying that he won't be the great Steph Curry next year again. I'm not saying that. But what I'm saying is, like, you're seeing the game catch up with that dude. You know, not necessarily. I mean, let me clarify. Not saying that he's been figured out, but I'm talking about more so his body. You know, those nicks and those bumps throughout an 82-game plus playoff season. Yeah, they're going to, you know, eventually catch up to you. That's why what LeBron is doing, going to what? Now, six straight finals? He'll be in the finals again this year. Six straight finals. That's why it's so amazing, dude. This dude plays international basketball. To play all that basketball and rarely miss a game due to injury, dude, like, you can't really just put that to the side and act like that's nothing. Because sustained greatness is, to me, what kind of separates the footnotes in history. And I'm not saying Steph Curry will be a footnote in history, but I can't see a situation where, knowing his past injury history and his current history, injury history, saying that, you know, we look around one day and Steph Curry is Kobe Bryant, 20 years in the league, you know, and climbing up these all-time scoring lists. I think there's a couple of good seasons in that body. But at a certain point, the game and the way people are playing him will, I think, catch up with him. That's why I enjoy it right now, and I'm lightweight pissed at what's going on in these damn playoffs right now, that he ain't balling. Like, win or lose, I don't care if they lose. I just always want to see. Like, I want to see Russ. Russ is doing what I want him to do. KD is getting busy. But Steph, you know, Steph is kind of not there, man, for whatever reason. And we'll get more into that as we go on. Now, talking back about this series and this game that's going on, that game five, man, they're back in Cleveland. LeBron and the boys are back home. And we'll see what's popping. I'm actually looking at some cut-ups of these shots that I talked about earlier, these open shots that are just missing. Kyrie's got to step up and do better, especially on the defensive end, because now, like, it's cool. Like, Kyrie's defensive deficiencies, and I talked about him yesterday, the way he plays pick-and-roll defense, those things are masked when the guy you're guarding, Kyle Lowry, is shooting 30%. But now when him and his backcourt running mate are both shooting over 50%, yep, guess what? The light gets shined on you, my man. You know, your man, everybody's favorite Australian hero last year, Dele, the dude that people were trying to convince me he was shutting down Steph Curry. Yeah, where has he been? Like, I think tonight you'll get a little bit more energy, especially from the home crowd. But this Toronto team is playing with a lot of confidence, man. And I think there's something to say about that. This young kid, Biyombo, he don't know no damn better. He don't know no damn better. He's like, whatever. He going up, blocking people's shots, both hands, too. He got LeBron the other day, and of course, LeBron got the foul call, which, by rule, like if he gets some body, but there's no, he just goes vertical. If you saw the play, like, LeBron got knocked down and all that, which, you know, again, a lot of times it's questionable, but he got knocked down, and the kid got called for a foul, but he knew, and we knew, it was clean block, man. So this kid is out there playing he's playing his ass off. Dudes is hitting shots. The other kid, Ross, is doing this thing. The other backup point guard is getting off. And I think they get, what's the kid's name? Monty Yunus. He was active last game but didn't play. But they're expecting him to play in this game. Things should get interesting, man. Things should get real interesting, man. Tristan Thompson got to get off his ass, man, because that's part, like, as crazy as it sounds, his offensive rebounding is a part of their offense. You know, coming down, and we saw it last night, coming down and getting two possessions every time down the court, or every time you miss almost, that's big. You know, extra possessions. We talk about it a lot of times in football when dudes kick onside kicks or recover fumbles or get interceptions, those extra possessions for your team, baseball, errors, extra at-bats, it matters, and it makes it a lot. It makes it hard to defeat a team. We start talking about, you know, the three-point shot being demoralizing, man. Offensive rebounds, I think, are just as demoralizing, if not more. You know what I mean? Because, in essence, it takes so much. Like, if Steph Curry's hitting 35-footers, it's like, all right, dude, what, you know, whatever. But if you play solid defense for a whole shot clock and the dude jacks up a bad shot and they end up with the ball again for another 24, yeah, man. You know, to say in your mind you're going to repeat that same defensive sequence, that's rough. You know what I mean? That's a hard deal to go with, man. I'll tell you what. I'm going to take a break here, and I'm going to come back. Got to do on this day. Got to take a daily look back. And also, I want to talk about Golden State and OKC. I kind of alluded to some of the things I'm going to mention here in the next segment. But this series is one that I can't do anything but put it into the category of disappointing. Not from the aspect of the Warriors. I mean, the Thunder, by the way. Not from that aspect. Like, if anything, they've been a pleasant surprise as an entire squad, man. From the coaching to the players, they've been a pleasant surprise. The disappointing part is your 2015 champions. You know, kind of looking befuddled. It's probably the best word I can find to use for them. But I'll talk about all that after the break. It's the One Mike with Big Mike Show with your host here, Big Mike. Heard on Spreaker.com every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. Also, via the website. Guys, just want to go straight into listening to the show. Check out the website, OneMikeWithBigMike.com. You can also get archived episodes there, as well as my social media information, man, Twitter and Instagram. And make sure you guys, if you want to get in on the conversation, join the live interactive chat room by clicking the little thought bubble you see dancing around on the streaming media player. I'm going to come back in just a minute.
This is Nnamdi Asamoah. I play football for the Philadelphia Eagles, but what I do off the field with United Way might be more important. I'm a volunteer tutor and mentor. Why? Because over a million kids a year drop out of school, and that's not okay. It takes 12 years to create a graduate, but it takes about the same time to create a dropout. And the difference between a child becoming one or the other could be me, or it could be you. Studies show that if we get to these kids earlier, their chances are better, and kids who read well by third grade are more likely to graduate. So join me in United Way. Suit up and take the pledge. Become a volunteer reader, tutor, or mentor. Because when a child succeeds, we all succeed. Give. Advocate. Volunteer. Live United. Take the pledge at unitedway.org. Brought to you by United Way, the Ad Council, and the National Football League.
Hey, Nick Cannon here. So, of course, we all know there's lots of talent in America. But unfortunately, there's something else we've got way too much of. Childhood hunger. 17 million kids struggle with it in this country. But here's the thing. This problem is entirely solvable. Seriously, we already produce more than enough healthy, nutritious food in this country to feed every single last one of those hungry kids. We just need a way to get it to them. That's why the Feeding America Nationwide Network of Food Banks is out there every day gathering surplus food to give hope to hungry kids and their families all across the country. But they need your help. Join me in supporting Feeding America and your local food bank at feedingamerica.org. Together we can solve hunger. Together we're Feeding America.
A message from Feeding America and the Ad Council.
Welcome back to the One Mike with Big Mike show, the Wednesday edition, a.k.a. Hump Day. All right, welcome back. Appreciate everybody for joining me on this Wednesday, getting on over this hump. Don't forget, tell your friends, man. Share the experience with your friends, man, or your enemies. I don't care. Tell them they can check out the show every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday via Spreaker.com. That's Spreaker.com. It's like speaker, but put an R in between the P and the E. They also have an app for all your mobile devices where you can check the show out, as well as any archived episodes going all the way back to when I started this thing up in November, man. You can do the same thing via the website, man, at the number one, MICWITHBIGMIKE. That's One Mike with Big Mike.com. All my social media information is there as well for my Facebook and my Twitter. Also, you guys can send me email straight from the contact page on the website, so go ahead and check that out. And if you guys have a business, or you know anyone else who has a business and would like to partner up, maybe sponsor an hour or a segment of the show, by all means, man, tell them to hit me up and we'll see definitely what we can do. Well, I mean, if we can work something out or whatnot. But right now, as we do each and every episode around this time or at the top of the hour, depending on if we have a guest or not, we take a look back, man, and we call it on this day.
Now, let's take a look back. On this day.
Yep. All right. The Hump Day edition of On This Day goes something like this. On this day in 1876, the first tie in National League history took place between the Philadelphia Athletics and the Louisville Grays. It was a 2-2 ball game in 14 innings. I guess this is before they had lights and night games being played. This is a while ago, so in 1876, I'm assuming like it got dark and they was like, all right, no one's winning, tie ball game, because now, you know, games go like 8-9 hours if no one's won. They use up all their players and everything. On this day in 1935, Babe Ruth, he hit his last home run. It was a 3-home run game versus the Pittsburgh Pirates. He was, in fact, with the Boston Braves at the time. Braves stand up, although they were in Boston at the time. Yeah, he had his last home run, 714, which, you know, stood for like 40 years, 39 years, something like that. Hammering Hank Aaron, who many believe still is the actual reigning home run champion in baseball. He ended up breaking that record. On this day in 1935, the great Jesse Owens, he equals or breaks 6 world records in 1 hour at the Olympics, one being the 100-meter dash. He did it in like 9.4 seconds. On this day in 1959, the U.S. Supreme Court rules that Louisiana prohibiting black, white boxing is unconstitutional. Look at that. That came before the Civil Rights Act. In 19, almost 10 years before that, they ruled that in Louisiana, a black man had every right to beat the hell out of a white dude and vice versa. On this day in 1965, Muhammad Ali, he knocks out Sonny Liston in the first round, yeah, to win the heavyweight boxing title. On this day in 1975, the 29th NBA championship. Wonder why I'm bringing that up. Well, the Golden State Warriors swept at that time the Washington Bullets in four games. That was the last time before last year that the Golden State Warriors had won an NBA championship. Don't look like it's going to happen this year. We'll talk about that here in a second. On this day in 1979, Raul Gonzalez of Mexico competes in the 50,000-meter walk in a record 3 hours, 41 minutes, 38.4 seconds. On this day in 1983, Kirk Gibson, at this time of the Detroit Tigers, and Jorge Horta of the Toronto Blue Jays, they both hit inside the park home runs. On this day in 1984, the Boston Red Sox trade pitcher Dennis Eckersley, the Eck, to the Chicago Cubs for Bill Buckner. Oh, yeah. We all know the Bill Buckner situation, which I guess is kind of forgotten now. You know, the curse of the Bambino has been solved. They won a couple championships up there in Boston. So the Bill Buckner thing, was it the 86 World Series where the ball went through his legs? Yep, forgotten. And finally, on this day in 1997, Todd and Mel Stottlemyre became the first father and son to win 100 Major League Baseball games. And ladies and gentlemen, that is your Hump Day edition of On This Day. Absolutely. Now, yesterday, oh yeah, there was some pushing in getting done yesterday. Yeah, the Golden State Warriors, once again, man, they got it pushed all the way in. Like, the final score, far from indicative of how this game went, man. Like, even though they staged a valiant comeback effort on the back of one Klay Thompson, who, by the way, you know, that's the dude that, like, it's funny to talk about him in the sense of a streaky shooter, but not in the classic sense that you would think of, like, a J.R. Smith streaky. He's just a guy who, like, once it gets locked in, like, they come in bunches, man. Like, he's also a consistent shooter normally, but he's also a guy who can just get it rolling and end up, you see, like, 30-something points in a quarter. Last night, he scored, like, 19 straight. He's that guy. Problem for him was, ain't nobody else want to play basketball, man. No one else wanted to play no damn basketball yesterday. So, he got beat by, like, 20-something points. Yeah, I don't even have a score here in front of me, but my urge to go ahead and get up out of there at halftime, I fought against it, and I stayed till probably the last minute of the game. You know what I mean? I stayed all the way. And then, you know, the game itself, it revealed a lot of things. It at certain points became mildly entertaining as a whole. Like, the Oklahoma City side is like, yeah, they got things. They got it running on all cylinders, man. Billy Donovan's doing a hell of a job. I talked to Jovan Buha, Fox Sports, on Monday about it. It's like, Billy Donovan seems to know what the hell he's doing. You know what I mean? You know, outside of the fact that, of course, he's got, you know, two of the five best players from this year, if you go by the MVP voting, you know, in Durant and Westbrook. Yeah, you know, he seems to have gotten it going or figured it out. And part of the problem, if you're the Golden State Warriors with this team, is like, it's like this team, this Thunder team won 55 games this year, but no one had to play them a possible seven straight times every other day. You know, like, Russell Westbrook, man, like, the one thing that you gotta believe about that kid, you're not gonna outrun him. You know, like, as far as endurance wise, like, he's gonna run forever, man. And he's one of those dudes that feels like the adrenaline high just lasts. That, coupled with his physical prowess and how how in shape a human being he is. You're just not going, like, things might start off slow for him, but inevitably you're going to tire. And I'm saying that in the sense of, you know, guys like Klay Thompson having to guard him. Like, Klay Thompson is one of the best shooters in the league, and everyone knows that, but he's also a pretty good on-ball defender. But the problem is, very few people, man, can do both at that level. You know what I mean? Like, you can guard, like, a regular point guard. But to chase that dude, Russ, around all game and then still have your legs under you to concentrate on your offense, because then something's going to give. And last night you saw Klay get into foul trouble early. And then it was like, you got to put Steph on him. And, like, Steph is cool defensively, but, yeah, it's Russ, man. You know what I mean? It's still that dude. So that being said, right, there was a thought I had earlier today, and I made sure I wrote it down because sometimes I'll just start talking during the show and I forget, like, little things that I thought about during the day. So I kind of, like, jot them down on my phone. And the term that I came up with, like, they have Golden State, I mean, they have a champion's arrogance. And some of the reason that I think people root against them or whatnot. I don't necessarily understand it, but that's the, you know, again, that's the culture that we live in. You know what I mean? People can't be too good. And if they are, you better not let me know about it, or as I have to hate you. All right, whatever. But they have this thing, like, I think Steph sat down with whoever he sat down with, and the statement he made was that we have our game plan and we're going to stick to it. And that's, like, one of those things, like, this is what we do. This is how we won 73 games, and it should be good enough to beat this team. And, for, you know, run it. You're down 3-1 now, but run it. You feel me? Usually that might be the case, but now you got to play the same team every other day. And this is a team, and the reason, like, I don't have no problem with seeing them in the finals, because they have what you kind of saw Golden State have last year. You know what I mean? They have that sense of there's something big on the horizon for us, and they want it. I truly believe that Kevin Durant doesn't want to leave Oklahoma City. You know, it's a place, and again, I talked about it with Jovan Buha on Monday, you know, the Fox Sports writer. It's a place that's embraced him. It's coddled him in a certain sense. You remember, like, 2 years ago, maybe 2-3 years ago, the local paper, the Oklahoman or whatever it's called, they called Kevin Durant out. They gave him, like, this witty name because he blew the game or something like that. And he got mad about it, and they wrote a retraction. They took it back. Like, that doesn't happen. Like, even in Atlanta, like, as kind of, like, watery and kind of as watery as this media market is for sports, that really ain't going to happen. You know what I mean? But in Oklahoma City, it happened, and it kind of just happened. No one cared. I don't think he wants to leave that. I don't think he wants to leave that and go to L.A., be the guy to follow Kobe. Definitely not to New York or wherever. Like, Golden State, it's like, there's a bunch of cooks in the kitchen, man. In Golden State, I think where he's at, coupled now with what they're doing, like, I'm not 100%, I'm not going to 100% say this Golden State squad is done, right? Just because of, you know, just to exhibit some level of respect to the champion, to last year's champion, the team that won 73 games. Here's the other thing, too. Like, don't be stupid enough to feel like not winning, not repeating as champions in some way diminishes what they did in the regular season. Don't do that to yourself. You know what I mean? As a younger person, I'm the dude that said when Tom Brady and them lost in the Super Bowl to the Giants after going, what, 18-0 or whatever it was, 19-0, whatever it was, and then losing that last game, I was the young dude that said, man, they might as well went like 0-16. No, that's ridiculous. I was being stupid. Nah, that's an accomplishment, man. That's something to be very, very proud of, and to have the sentiment that now the 73 games didn't matter, it shows a lack of understanding of just how hard it is to win basketball games at that level, or to win, in the case of the Patriots, football games, and to win all of them. Like, even if you're playing, like, I don't know who's a bad team, the Browns, every game, to win all of them still, you know, that's something. There's something to be said for that. Now, of course, you know, them repeating would have kind of put a cherry on top of it, but we got to understand, too, and the thing that y'all got to kind of keep in the back of your mind, that it's not that easy. Just because you and a lot of people, including myself, saw it as a foregone conclusion about, I don't know, three quarters of the way through the season. You know, I think I made the statement that, can we just hurry up and get to San Antonio, Golden State in the conference finals? You know what I mean? I think I made that statement. So because we now look like idiots, it doesn't mean that, you know, it doesn't mean that it was really going to be as easy as some of us portrayed it to be, easy to win a second championship in a row. Now, again, the series isn't over. You know, Steph and the boys today came out, we don't want to go out this way and all that. You might not have a choice, my man. It's called a buzzsaw. You feel me? And you just ran into one, man. These dudes have found something. That, coupled with the fact that a lot of the things that you got away with early on, is even in these playoffs. And one more thing on this whole tarnishing of the 73 games. Don't call this a collapse. They're in the Western Conference Finals. They didn't bow out in five games in the first damn round. That's ridiculous. And two, you don't want to be disrespectful to Golden State and act, I mean, not Golden State, to Oklahoma City, and act like they're some like bum ass squad that don't have no business being here. No. Look at the game. Look at the game, man. It's there in vivid HD color, man. It's a good basketball team. Now, of course, throughout the course of 82 games, they had to figure some things out, man. And some people on their squad are playing above their heads. You know, Steven Adams, a kid who had like six double-doubles in the regular season, got like seven or eight now. Yeah, things like that happen. Bismack Biyombo, I talked about it in the last segment. You know, this is the time of the year where it happens. Just so happens, on the other side of the court, on the other bench, dudes who've had spectacular years, Steph Curry and one Draymond Green, yeah, they're peeing down their pants, especially Draymond, man. You know, for all the stuff about the kick and all this kind of stuff, and, like, I didn't understand yesterday, like, watching and reading yesterday, the basketball fans and people who were up in arms that Draymond Green needs to be suspended. Hold on, I don't want to see, like, okay, I understand you have a feeling about what he did, but I don't want to see, like, I don't want to see, you know, the best or Oklahoma City's best not play against Golden State's best at any point in the series, unless something just horrible happens. You know what I mean? Which I don't see going down. The other thing I say about that is, it almost felt like last night that they might as well have suspended the dude, man. The way he was playing, the timid way he was going about his business. Steve Kerr even had to take him out at the beginning of the game to kind of like tell him to get his crap together, man. You know what I mean? Like, this ain't the time that you want to start doing that. I'm like, tomorrow, yeah, I look for this dude to be on 10. You know what I mean? Just on some, like, look, if this is going to be it and if we got to go out, I'm going to go out being me. That's what I look to happen tomorrow. And I don't think anything like anything flagrant or anything like that's going to happen. But when you kind of like hang that suspension over someone's head, and we all know like flagrant fouls tend to be based on the referee's discretion and their perspective. So something, he could foul somebody hard, and the next thing you know, it's a flagrant. And that means suspension immediately. It's hard. So for whatever he wanted to say yesterday about, oh, I'm not going to worry about it, I'm just going to play my game. You're human, man. You're a human being. You know what I mean? And you know your team needs you. But the reality is, they need you. That team needs Draymond Green to be who he is. Now, I've talked about this at nauseam, man. And this is why that MVP conversation, it just can't be. The name of the award has to be different, or needs to be different. I don't think it has to be, because the NBA, I think, loves the conversation that surrounds it every year. on the word value or valuable. But it should be the most outstanding player. You know what I mean? That's what it should be. Whoever was the most outstanding for that particular year makes more sense to me. Because in essence, I think Draymond Green is the most valuable player on that team. Case in point, Steph Curry missed a couple games, right? They won some and they lost one or whatever. But no one ever like just stuck it in, you know, just like rammed it in there, no grease. Now Draymond's not playing like Draymond, and they getting ran off the damn court. Like Draymond's having like historically bad performances, man, and the teams aren't even close. And part of what it is that Draymond is able to a lot of times take the pressure off Steph Curry. He's able to go pick and roll with Steph Curry, and then when he's making decisions and making the right ones, as well as when he's hitting his shot, it changes the complexion of the other team's defense. Speaking of that other team's defense, it's amazing, man, how you can kind of poison yourself. The Golden State Warriors, in a way, kind of poison themselves. It's like they have this lineup, and they call it the lineup of death. It's their small ball lineup. And they force people to play for the last 2 years, seasons. They force people to play that way because no other team has had bigs that could deal with them when they're on offense. And then when they're on defense, Draymond and some of the other guys are able to help gang rebound so they don't get killed on the boards by size. It's a whole different ball game now, because now Billy Donovan is like, yeah, I'm going to put my quote unquote, I'm doing the rabbit ears, my small ball lineup in there against yours. But the problem is your small ball lineup, the dude you got playing power forward is 7 feet tall. So Draymond has no, and he's as athletic as Draymond, if not more. And can get his own shot. Like, he gets to that free throw line area as many times a game as he wants to, and it's just a matter of him hitting the shot at that point. You got Serge Ibaka, who's now playing as an interior player more so now than he played for a lot of the regular season. He's still hitting threes and shooting jump shots, but defensively, he's doing a lot better job at the rim. It's making it very, very difficult for Golden State to do what they want to do. They're able to switch these pick and rolls, which has always been a problem. Steven Adams, by the way, has 2 block shots against Steph Curry. One person blocked his shot all season long from 3. One! And speaking of Steph, man, I don't know, man. Folks want to talk. They want to talk about the dude not being right and not being 100% healthy. Look, man, I don't know what game this is for a lot of these dudes, you know, creeping up on 100, maybe 100 games. I don't think anybody's totally there all the way. Now, of course, Steph has had a couple of injuries. He had the ankle early, and then he had the knee, and then he dove into the sidelines, which, by the way, like, if they lose this series, man, and we find out, like, a week later that, you know, the elbow thing was more than what it was, that's what y'all get, man. That's what y'all ass get. Like, them dudes who were sitting in the front row and not catching this cat, and it's not like Andrew Bogut was coming at you. It's like a 180-pound skinny dude coming at you, man. It ain't gonna take that much to try to hold him up and not let him just go all the way to the floor, bust his elbow wide open. They told us that he didn't have to get it drained or whatever after he had that big knot on it. But still, you know, that's the shooting elbow. Now, the same game, he went off for, you know, some, like what was it? What was it, 13 points in 50 seconds or something crazy like that? I can't remember the actual numbers and how they pair up. But people who've written articles today want to go to that. Like, okay, you can't tell me that something's wrong with him and he did that. Well, there's a such thing as adrenaline. You know, just like in game 2 when they had to have that ball game. Yeah, you know, sure. You can kind of get up past the knee problems. He said before the series, it's like, look, the knee is still sore. There's still pain there. But now that's what it's about. It's about pain management. I got to go. So, nah, he's not full strength. And for a dude that does what he does and shoots from the distance he shoots from, yeah, you need your legs, man. You need your legs, and that elbow needs to be straight. So it's like the compound of both. And again, not making excuses. Like, if you on the basketball court, I want to see you play basketball. Do your thing. Because at a certain point yesterday, I was like, man, what the hell is going on? I think I even tweeted, man, Steph has never been this off to where, like, he's missing layups. He's at the rim. I read you guys the stats like 2 weeks ago, how prolific this dude is at the rim. One dude had a better percentage than him excuse me, from that close, DeAndre Jordan, a dude that just catch lobs and putbacks. This dude's a point guard. But yesterday, man, nothing, man. Like, he's missing badly, too. He's, like, shooting layups over the rim. You know what I mean? Not even getting the rim, just hitting off the backboard on the other side of the rim. Craziness. And, like, again, it's a possibility that he ain't right. But those are the breaks, man. That's what happens, man. Your best player is 180 pounds. He's primarily a jump shooter, but, you know, he gets into the rim at will. For the most part, he gets, you know, if it's one-on-one, he's gonna kill you off the dribble, man. But when you see his shot start getting blocked by the bigs, it's like Steven Adams, like, he's out there, like, my thing that I always holler out when I see Steph out there, you know, getting busy with a big, I'm like, yeah, it's time to dance, big boy. Like, Steven Adams ain't dancing, dude. He's just sitting there. He's just spreading, getting wide, and just sitting there. And then when Steph goes up, he think he got that space. That dude is long enough twice now to get a piece of the basketball. You know, and that seems to be what is the that seems to be the code for that lineup of death. The length, man. You know, the length, and to for anybody to feel like, you know, this is like the new way, you got to have those dudes too now. You know what I mean? Like, everybody feel like they know what the blueprint is. Ah, okay. you put two of the top five players on another team. That's what you do, too, because you got to get buckets as well. And that seems to be, too, the biggest disappointment. Like, these dudes, it feels like they're in their own heads. Things aren't going right offensively. So, you know, the lagging, Steph jogging around on defense, jogging back. You know, the 50-50 game was ridiculous, man. Ridiculous. Every loose ball, every... You know, not every, but so many times, offensive rebounds, second attempts at the basketball goal. That's how runs happen, man. When you don't close out defensive possessions, yeah, that's how teams go on runs. And that Thunder team had way more. You know, like I said, Klay went on his own little personal run, but at the end of the day, you can't really just rely on that, on one dude to get going and be that hot, because had he not. Like, just say he was regular, like a regular player. Man, it would got ugly. It would got super, super, like, uglier. Let me say it that way. It would have gotten uglier. I don't know. Like, I'm not going to be surprised. Let's say it that way. I'm not going to be surprised if the series ends tomorrow, which would be a shame. I wanted to go seven, man, because I call this, you know, a real point guard matchup, man. Like, two dudes, man, like, getting it. But, like, Russ is, like, a different guy. And, you know, it's a lot of people starting to realize it now. You know what I mean? Like, I've been kind of on Team Russ for a minute, man, for some years now, since I was doing, like, CBS radio. So that's, like, at least five, man. Like, you know, and back to the whole point about Kevin Durant not wanting to leave there. Part of it is his dude. Jovan Buha told me the other day, told us Monday that, you know, he could see a scenario where Kevin just kind of comes back and signs one of those LeBron deals, you know, the 2-year with the opt-out, and then sees what Russ does. You know, if Russ comes back and they built the team significantly to his satisfaction, you'll see more of him. But, you know, you do the 2-year deal when Russ becomes a free agent, you see what he does, and then you make your move from there. By the way, like, folks in Seattle, like, every time they do something good, like, this likely will be their second time in the finals. Like, folks in Seattle's like, man, what the hell? And, like, here's the other thing, too. Let me say this before I get up out of here for this segment. If Kevin Durant, if he beats the Thunder, and then turns around and then beats LeBron James in the finals and gets him a championship ring. Oh, no doubt. If he wasn't already like the anti-LeBron, the guy who can do no wrong, he definitely will be now. You know, because it'll always be LeBron had to leave and all and go play with his buddy. Like, Kevin Durant got drafted by this team when they were the damn Sonics. Yeah. For him to do that and ride this thing all the way out with all the turmoil that people tried to create between he and Russ and win a championship. Yup. Watch what I say. The anti-LeBron, B. And then he'll get so much more love. And his one championship will have so much more gleam on it than LeBron's two. You know what I mean? And I'm like, I don't know if that's right or I don't really live in the world of fair, so I don't know. But I'm telling you, that's what's going to happen. I'm going to come back. We got to talk about the NFL, man. We got to get into this NFL stuff. We're getting ready for tip-off in about another 30 minutes with the Toronto Raptors and Cleveland Cavaliers at, Quicken Loans Arena in Cleveland. This is the One Mike with Big Mike Show. Of course, I am Big Mike. Appreciate you guys for joining me on this hump day. Check out the website, onemikewithbigmike.com. Make sure you tell a friend to tell a friend about the show every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday on Spreaker.com. That's Spreaker.com, as well as the app. You guys can check me out and join the show via the live interactive chat room. Just click that little thought bubble you see dancing around there on your on the media player. You guys can let your thoughts be known. You can critique and comment and ask questions and all those good things, man. So, I'm going to come back, get into some of this NFL stuff. Very, very interesting stuff in the NFL, too. We'll do that next right here, One Mike with Big Mike.
We asked kids what it took to be a dad. This is what they had to say.
A father is always present. I mean, what real father figure can you have if they're not there?
In order to be a good dad, you need to love.
One Mike.
We asked kids what it took to be a dad. This is what they had to say.
A father is always present. I mean, what real father figure can you have if they're not there?
In order to be a good dad, you need to love your son. You need to put gas in your car so you don't break down in the middle of nowhere. And you need to make them breakfast. Yep.
I mean, just to maybe play like a board game with me, or to just stay home and play some video games with me. Just to do like that one little thing is what I really look forward to.
I'm not asking him to be a perfect dad, but he should try.
He's just a constant force in my life.
There's no other type of love like a dad's love because it's not comparable to anything else.
Take time to be a dad today. Call 877-4DAD-411 or visit fatherhood.gov. Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services and the Ad Council.
Hi, this is Terry Crews, actor, former football player, game show host, father of five, and all-around big dude. I'm also an expert on drama. I know all kinds of drama. There's the good kind that comes with having a house full of kids. There's the bad kind, like season-ending injuries. There's the necessary kind, like having an agent in Hollywood. And there's silly drama, like the drama around my percolating pectorals. And then there's the drama you can skip.
Skip the drama that comes with not having your high school diploma or equivalency. Find free adult education classes near you and finish your high school diploma. Visit finishyourdiploma.org.
Or text DIPLOMA to 97779. Message and data rates may apply. Reply STOP to opt out. That's DIPLOMA to 97779. And leave the drama to actors like me.
Brought to you by the Dollar General Literacy Foundation and the Ed Council.
One Mike.
All I need is one mic.
What's the name of the show?
One Mike with Big Mike.
You know, ain't nobody getting hurt, anybody. You know, there's no crime being committed.
And they say his style is too urban for the radio.
This is real life stuff that's happened to me.
Well, you know what?
You.
One Mike with Big Mike.
I like to be able to do what I want to do.
A sports talk show.
But no subject matter is off limits.
Meek Mill's concert is not called
the Hell Yeah, I Banged Khloe Kardashian concert.
And now, your host.
Put your hands together for the one, the only.
Big Mike.
All I need is one mic. One mic with Big Mike here. Second hour of the show. Appreciate you guys for joining me. I, of course, am Big Mike. Here with you till about, well, for about another hour or so. 54 more minutes. Got game five of the NBA Eastern Conference Finals coming up here in just a second, in about 25 minutes, so in case I get distracted. I'm going to try to get y'all up out of here, man, for that, though. I ain't trying to hold y'all all day. By the way, this is the Hump Day edition of the One Mike with Big Mike Show, heard on Spreaker.com, Spreaker.com is how you spell that. You guys can also download the app for all your mobile devices, whatever format or what is it called? Whether using Windows, Android, Apple, all those things, man. The Spreaker app is prime for it. If you didn't get a chance to hear the first hour of the show, and you want to go back, it's quite simple. Go to my website, man. Go to onemicwithbigmike.com. You'll see the archived there's an archive tab, or it might say more or something like that. I don't know. I haven't been there in a while. Or you can go to Spreaker. All archived episodes are there if you want to later on go back and check out what I said in the first hour about the Golden State Warriors versus the Oklahoma City Thunder, or the Cavs and the Raptors game that's about to go on in a second. You can also check it out if you got the iTunes app or the TuneIn app on your phone. The episodes are also archived there, as well as on YouTube, man. So, you know, I'm everywhere that you're trying to be, man, trying to get this listenership up. I appreciate everybody who checks me out every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, even if you don't jump on in the live interactive chat room, which, by the way, if you want to, on the live streamer, wherever you're listening, just click on the little thought bubble you see dancing around on the live streamer. That'll take you to the live interactive chat room. You guys can holler at me and share your thoughts and holler at each other or whatnot. But if you just listen, you know, which most sports radio listeners do, they just listen. I appreciate you, man. I also appreciate everyone who you know, exchanges thoughts with me on social media during the day and all those kind of things. Some, you know, a little bit dumber than the others, but, you know, no one said it was a crime to be stupid, so I'll respect your rights in all situations. I'll respect that right that you have to be a dumbass. Speaking of dumbasses, perfect segue into the land of the National Football League. Let's see where I want to start. You know where? I'm not going to start with a dumbass. I'm going to start with someone, well, now I think he's a dumbass. The Bills GM, Doug Whaley, yesterday said something on, I think it was WWRGAM or WWGAM. I'm sorry, I don't have the correct credit with me. I'll have it here in just a second. But he's talking about Sammy Watkins' injury. You know, Shaq Lawson has a shoulder with a local radio station. But then at some point, he said this.
Are part of it. It's a violent game that I personally don't think humans are supposed to play, and these things are going to come up, but we trust in our medical staff, and we trust in each individual athlete to just do what they have to do to get back on the field.
It's a violent sport that I personally don't think humans should play. Right? Okay. A lot of people took umbrage to that. Me and my dude Jake was going back and forth today about it. And, like, people start getting real, like, stupid and real ridiculous about, like, so what does he think? Androids are going to play? Like, understand what you heard him say. I don't think humans are supposed to play. A game that I don't think humans are supposed to play. And it's something that I've told people for a long time. I'm a guy who played football all the way through my college years. Played at a 1AA team in school at Tennessee Tech University. What is it called now? FCS school, yeah, in Tennessee. Now, the thing with football, as I've constantly explained, man, is that it's not a natural. It doesn't chime into your natural instincts. You know what I mean? There's nothing like if someone, like, I'm about 250 pounds, right? If I just saw you in the street, right, and I just took off running at you, what you would do naturally is try to avoid me. Get out of the way. You know, it's WGR 550 AM in Buffalo. That's where the sound came from. But in football, you have to go against that natural instinct. Your natural instinct now has to be to stop this large object using only my body. Yeah. There's nothing natural about that. Your body isn't made to do that on a consistent basis. So you have to be a little bit different. You have to be a little bit different upstairs. Not constantly, but during that time. And then people start going into the whole, well, your body's not made to throw a curveball either. Or your body's not made to do this. Like, all those things are, yeah, okay, fine. I will say this, though. If you know, I know people don't try to act like they don't understand evolution, but it is a thing. But your body has evolved to do certain things, not necessarily just for sport. Like my guy Jake was like, you know, all sports are man-made. So in that sense, they're all unnatural. The first thing I'll tell you is the 100-meter dash. okay, a man created the rules and all that kind of stuff, but running is as natural to any human being, to a baby. If you start chasing your infant around, if they can walk, they'll run. That's what we do. You're made to run. So that theory is flawed right there. Yeah, there's certain parts of football that naturally we've evolved to be able to do to survive at a certain point in history, like throwing, right? Because, of course, most animals in nature, look at them. They kill up and close. A lion goes up and they run up and they dive on a zebra or dive on a gazelle or whatever. A human can't do that. Our appendages aren't really made to do that kind of stuff. So we develop the ability to throw things and kill things from distance. Yeah, and as being as such, you know, way back in the day, we had to be able to run. We weren't the at the top of the food chain at one point. You know what I mean? Things were trying to kill us. I used to give people the example of this. Like my dad has never, ever, ever in life shot a basketball. But if my dad has a piece of paper wadded up in his hand and there's like a receptacle within a couple of feet, yeah, he won't get up and walk over there and put it in there. He'll try to make the basket. It's just something people do naturally. In baseball, you know, we've evolved to be able to use clubs and things of that to hit things. Stopping things with our bodies, not so much. But yeah, people lost their mind. And the argument that he can't say this because of where he works. Okay, maybe he shouldn't, because of where the NFL is right now and the report that came out on Monday about the NFL pulling funding from the NIH, a private research organization who they had promised money to research the possibilities of detecting chronic traumatic encephalopathy in the brains of living people rather than only dead people, who, by the way, they just reported that Bubba Smith, former NFL player, former, you know, Police Academy star, Big Bubba, he had CTE as well. I think the reality of it is frightening to the NFL. So not anytime someone says Doug Whaley, the Bills general manager, says, now you have the people who feel like they have to be the defenders of football. Football don't need no defending. Like, everything that's happening around the game of football right now is the game's fault. Because one lie, one cover-up begets another lie, and cover-up begets another lie, and cover-up, and so forth and so on. And all you doing, man, you covering up doo-doo with doo-doo. You know what I mean? You can't hide it. It's there. It stinks. Everyone smells it. So when Doug Whaley says this, I don't think any rational person hears that and says, well, here's what the irrational people hear that and say. That he's saying that no one should play football. Like, his job requires people playing football, but no one should play football. And no, that's not what it means. He's saying, he was talking in the context of people being injured and injuries being a part of the game. And that being what it is, the violent nature of the game and the way that you're trained, the things that you're trained to do in football are unnatural to human beings. He's right. We're not Rams. You know what I mean? Like, Rams do that. They go and just butt each other's heads and they go at it over and over and over again. We're not that. Our brains don't have the same protection as theirs do. And quite frankly, Rams don't need their brains like we do. So the comparisons with, like, people throwing curveballs and all that kind of stuff, fine. You throw a curveball, you throw your arm out, it is unnatural. It is. But the difference is, you're not going to want to blow your brains out. You're not going to go crazy because you threw too many curveballs. The evidence is becoming overwhelmingly so that the possibilities increase that you would do something like that if you keep on bashing your head against another human being over and over again. So the whole thing about, and I keep mentioning this every time something like this comes up, the whole we're going to make the game safer thing, it's stop. Speaking of, so this, and this is why now I can say Doug Whaley's an idiot. And man, I don't know if that may be too strong to call him an idiot, because he got a gig. You know what I mean? And I don't want to be that dude to be like, you know, stand up on your principles, screw your gig. This dude's worked hard to get into the position that he's in, you know, to just blow it over people not understanding and not being willing to accept this little thing called context. All right. So, of course, today, as is, I don't know if I'm going to use this right. Quid pro quo. Is that like the term used for saying as is, you know, standard operation? You say something, enough people react to it. You have to come back and retract it. You got to moonwalk off of it. And he did. And I want to give you guys, I want to read you guys the quote. He says, quote, clearly, I used a poor choice of words in my comment yesterday morning. As a former player who has the utmost respect and love for the game, the point I was trying to make is that football is a physical game and injuries are a part of it. Playing football, no doubt, is very physical, or is very physically, mentally, and emotionally challenging. And it is all part of what makes the game so compelling to play and watch. The game has more protection for players now than ever, thanks largely to the safety advancements and numerous rule changes made by our league and promoted to all levels of football. I believe our game continues to have a bright future, and I hope that this statement provides clarity to the intent of my earlier comment, end quote. No, it doesn't. It doesn't. It's placating to idiots, man. No. Like, at some point, man, I do want, like, I'm not trying to suggest this dude, you know, risk his gig and his check and all that, because this, you know, they pay this dude well to step and fetch and be in line, you know, with the company policy. But when we get to the point, man, we start ridiculing honesty. And it's not honesty for malice. He's not, you know, being that dude, you know, that comes home and tells his wife how fat she is to, you know, prove some type of point. No. This is a dude just having a conversation with two other dudes on a radio show and saying, like, look, man, my personal belief is that, you know, I don't think human beings are, and I'm going to paraphrase and I'm going to go into, like, mean, but human beings are made to play this game. And he's right. And all that stuff, man, this reeks of this being the company line. The game has never been safer. It's football, man. It's not going to be. Yeah, things can be safer. But to call them, like, it's not going to ever be safe. It's football, man. It's collisions. Dudes are getting bigger by the minute. You know what I mean? And they're getting faster, which means, like, I guess in physics, the collisions, man, are becoming more impactful. There's no way to run from that, man. None. But the NFL wants you to believe that they can. And that to me is the bigger problem. That they're continuously trying to fool people. And the people that are trying to fool are not us. Because we don't care. We don't care. These dudes get knocked out and all this kind of stuff. Like, maybe, like, there may be, like, levels of it. Like, you may care a little bit more. Like me, I know a few of guys, man, who played and are fearful of certain things moving forward, right? But I don't watch football with that on my mind, to be honest. I don't watch football like, man, golly, man, I feel so bad watching this. Nah, football is awesome. It is. You know, I've played a lot of football in my day. I've learned a lot from football. I've garnered a lot from football. Like, I don't go to college if I can't play a little bit of football. You know, quite frankly, and if I don't go to college, I'm still in Decatur doing whatever and getting into whatever. You know what I mean? So it's real. But I never appreciate people being lied to, because, like, life is not a linear thing. And those lies and those untruths, and you trying to cover up things, or you not, or you wanting to be sure that scientific results come out in your favor so it doesn't make you look bad, they have ripple effects, man. Like, Dave Duerson had a family. Junior Seau had a family. Feel me? These dudes that's dying, Javon Belcher. Like, that dude's baby girl will never know her dad, man. All these dudes, man, that you know, post-mortem, we end up knowing, we know they end up having CTE, man, and they displayed so many of the symptoms that are associated with the disease. Now, dude's not playing football, dude's playing football, it's whatever. But I just truly believe in any situation, it is, it's incumbent upon the person that's putting you in harm's way or allowing you to be in, to go into harm's way, to say, like, look, man, this is what's happening right now. Now, it's, it is what it is. These players, they have a sense of what the dangers are, right? But now, you know, you're looking at the situation on Monday where the NFL is trying to curve the science and curve it back to where it doesn't put the NFL in a bad light. Now, if you're a player, you're looking at that like, yeah, what the hell, man? You know, we at some point, man, we need to be able to believe what's happening. So, you know, as Eugene Monroe for the Baltimore Ravens suggested, you know, he suggested like the NFL funding, you know, marijuana or cannabis research, because it's been shown that the cannabinoids within the plant can help in some ways reverse the effects of head trauma. Don't want to do that. You know, the NFL, like, if Congress is this involved in the NFL's concussion research, and again, because I mentioned this on Monday, because without the NFL's money, the taxpayers would have to pick up the tab. And with them pulling their money, now Roger Goodell, in all fairness, let me make sure I do add that part to the story. Roger Goodell came back, and of course he denied the things that the NFL is accused of as far as pulling back funding and trying to and the conflict of interest that involve them wanting a guy who works for the NFL to be a part of the independent study. Here's what Roger Goodell had to say. Here's his quote. Quote, "I take a much different position to that on several fronts. One is our commitment to medical research is well documented by them." Anyway, continue the quote. "We made a commitment to the NIH. It is normal practice to have discussions back and forth with the NIH. We have several members that are advisors on our committees, Betsy Nagel, Richard Ellen Bogan, who have experience with NIH or worked with NIH. It is very important to continue to have that kind of dialogue through appropriate channels, which our advisors have. That's a standard practice. We have our commitment of $30 million to NIH. We're not pulling that back one bit. We continue to focus on things our advisors believe are important to the study. Ultimately, it is the NIH's decision." End quote. Then why the hell they got to check with you then? Like, if it's an independent study, they shouldn't have to talk to the NFL before they do anything. If you're giving them the money, and I forget what the term was used, but you're giving them the money essentially with no strings attached. Like, here's the money, do what you got to do. But now, all of a sudden, it's like, okay, you got to talk to our people. We got this council. We got people who used to work for you guys, so you need to talk to them about. And then he goes on to talk about how Congress should have talked to their medical people before they release their findings. What the hell, man? Come on, B. Nah, that ain't how it work. You wrong, man. And this is a story that I covered and spoke about. It had to be like 2 months ago. 2 months ago I brought this up, man. The fact that this was happening. And that just, to me, that ain't cool. Like, that's not cool. People are going to play football, man. It's going to happen. Because of a lot of times the immediate gratification and the immediate changing of circumstances that football provides that basketball doesn't necessarily provide in that larger scale, or definitely that baseball doesn't. You know, they have like three different drafts, and it's like 90 rounds a draft, and you know, you got to go through the minor league system before you start making that real bread. With football, you get drafted, man. At the very least, you're going to get, you know, a couple grand, you know, 10 to 30. I think I remember DJ Shockley many years ago, former Georgia quarterback, former Atlanta Falcons quarterback. I remember him getting drafted in the seventh round, and his signing bonus was 70 grand. ain't a bad way to start off your life. Like, if you never play it down in the NFL, you got 70 grand, you know, to start off your life with. And this was over 10 years ago, I think. You know, and I talked to DJ about this at one point when I was doing the radio show with CBS. And I don't know, I think he said he bought a car with the money or something like that. But yeah, for a kid, you know, who won't have much, who, like, the kid from Auburn that, you know, entered the draft, the running back, so that he could help his mom out. Your mom's homeless, sleeping on his sister's couch or whatnot, in a one-bedroom or two-bedroom apartment with all her kids or whatnot. Yeah, 70 grand goes a long way, man. So as long as that's in place and the money's not going down, like, I don't know what it is. Now, it has to be for a seven-round pick. I would assume it's, like, in the six figures right now, the minimum, right, as far as the signing bonus goes. Or it may have gone down since the new CBA is in place. I'm not sure what it is now. But the fact of the matter is you get more than you had the day before. And as long as that's in place and as long as all these kids feel like no kid feels like, yeah, man, I can't wait to be a seventh-round pick. As long as these dudes feel like all of them can be first-round picks, yeah, the NFL ain't got nothing to worry about. Well, I'm not going to say that either. I'm not going to say they don't have anything to worry about, because there are certain sectors of society that they still want to be involved in the game. Like, if the NFL, as black as you think it is right now, if it just goes like 85, 90, 95% black, it's gonna have the same problems like the NBA had for a while. Like, people always talking about this NBA dress code and all this kind of stuff. Well, the NBA had to kind of get over a certain stigma to invite a certain group of people back to the game and for them to be interested in the game. You know what I mean? So David Stern felt like dressing up the players and not looking like Allen Iverson, but putting the players in a dress code would help that. But now the NFL, I think the NBA now is popular. It may be as popular as it's ever been. And it's accessible to everyone, but it's the same thing all the way around. I think that may, in fact, be, and this thought just came to my mind, the NFL's biggest fear. Like, you want to have still those Tom Brady's, man, and those Big Ben's, especially at that position. You know what I mean? You want to have those dudes, man. You don't want, like, I don't think they want to have a bunch of Cam Newtons. As great a player, as good a player as Cam Newton is, yeah. And then, like here's the reality, too. Like, Cam Newton, to me, I said this last year, like, I think he's about as good as you're going to get. You know what I mean? The kid with no tattoos, low haircut, clean cut, you know, shaven, clean shaven dude, you know, wearing, he always got on the suit at the press conference. I think that's about as good as you get. Now, his vernacular will improve. Like, Cam tried to throw out some things every now and then that you're like, oh, Cam, that's not how you use that one. But, you know, whatever. I do it too, but, you know, I'm not on that level where people are, you know, looking at me for comments either. But as time goes on, he'll get it together. Trust me. If you ever heard Michael Strahan, if you ever seen any of his rookie interviews, like, he's as country as a syrup sandwich. You feel me? But look at him now. Michael Strahan can't get off TV, off of shows. You know what I mean? And when he do, it's a big deal. It's everywhere. So, yeah, Cam will figure it out. But I think as far as the appearance part goes and what you see, he got it. Now, the issue is when, you know, dudes show up and they got, like, the RG3 thing. I don't know what that hair thing he got going on is called, but, you know, they show up and that's the move. Well, you know, you know, we got to figure something else out, you know. But, nah, the NFL, as a league, feels to me like they're looking like way past, you know what I'm saying, way past today. Like, today is not the issue. It's moving forward and getting to the point where, you know, we can continue to grow, because they want to go to, like, London and all this kind of stuff, and they want to go to China and all this foolishness, which is whatever. You know, increasing the talent pool, I guess, again, in 20 years, you know, you start seeing Chinese players in the NFL. And there's been Asian players. I remember Dat Nguyen played for the Cowboys at one point, kid out of Texas A&M. There's been Asian players, but, you know, more so. More from, you know, the other side of the pond, as they say. All right. Game's about to start, man. Eastern Conference Finals Game 5 is about to start. If you're listening live, you can kind of mute that and listen to me if you want to. No, I'm playing. I'm going to come back, wrap the show up. I got to talk about the Falcons. We got to talk about the Falcons being awarded the Super Bowl, man. 2019 here in Atlanta, where I'm at, where I'm from. And some of the things that kind of surrounded that particular, you know, particular selection or whatnot. We'll do that next. It's the One Mic with Big Mic show on Spreaker and on the website, onemicwithbigmic.com. You guys can go check that out. Also, man, make sure you guys are following me on Twitter and Instagram at the number one, MICWITHBIGMIKE. Go ahead and give me a follow, man. Check out some of my ignorance. And once again, if you guys are going to check out the game and you're going to leave me here, make sure you guys come back via Spreaker, via the website, via TuneIn, YouTube, iTunes, and you guys can, you know, check the show out later. You can download it or stream it from those particular applications. I'll be right back.
Hey, Nick Cannon here. So, of course, we all know there's lots of talent in America. But unfortunately, there's something else we've got way too much of. Childhood hunger. 17 million kids struggle with it in this country. But here's the thing, this problem is entirely solvable. Seriously, we already produce more than enough healthy, nutritious food in this country to feed every single last one of those hungry kids. We just need a way to get it to them. That's why the Feeding America Nationwide Network of Food Banks is out there every day gathering surplus food to give hope to hungry kids and their families all across the country. But they need your help. Join me in supporting Feeding America and your local food bank at feedingamerica.org. Together we can solve hunger. Together we're Feeding America.
A message from Feeding America and the Ad Council.
We asked kids what it took to be a dad. This is what they had to say.
A father is always present. I mean, what real father figure can you have if they're not there?
In order to be a good dad, you need to love your son. You need to put gas in your car so you don't break down in the middle of nowhere. And you need to make them breakfast. Yep.
I mean, just to maybe play like a board game with me, or to just stay home and play some video games with me. Just to do like that one little thing is what I really look forward to.
I'm not asking him to be a perfect dad, but he should try.
He's just a constant force in my life.
There's no other type of love like a dad's love, because it's not comparable to anything else.
Take time to be a dad today. Call 877-4DAD-411 or visit fatherhood.gov. Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services and the Ad Council.
Welcome back to the One Mic with Big Mic show on this hump day. Almost there, man. Almost there. Game time rolling around. Tip off coming up here in just a couple minutes, man. And the Cavaliers-Raptors Game 5 of the Eastern Conference Finals. I started the show off talking about, I had to, you know, say my piece on this whole George Zimmerman gun situation. Also, talked about the Cleveland Cavaliers, this game that's about to come on. Talked about Eastern Conference Finals and the Western Conference Finals. And moved on from there to talk about the NFL, man. The NFL still holding fast to this whole company line of making the game safer. And one of their own, Doug Whaley, again, it's like the second time in a couple of months, one of their own have kind of parted from the company line, the script, and said something that they feel like he shouldn't have said. I felt like he was, you know, very honest, and what he said is very true, that, you know, football is not a game that human beings are supposed to play. You know what I mean? People do it, of course. There's a lot of things that we do that we're not supposed to do. Only in this case, it, you know, is now being proven more and more that it can lead to very, very dire repercussions as you age, and the further away you are from the game. Bubba Smith just getting the news just coming out that he's been diagnosed, that he posthumously was diagnosed with CTE. So, moving on, I got a couple more things I want to get out to you guys before I close up shop today. I want to talk about the Atlanta Falcons and one of baseball's greats, Tony Gwynn, and what's happening with his family. as well. But first, I want to start off with, you know, the good news, I guess. For the city, I guess, it's some good news. Arthur Blank followed the script, the NFL script that they've given most teams. Not really giving them, but, you know, people know what it is. You build a new stadium, let's rock and roll, right? Let's get the Super Bowl in here. The Falcons last had a Super Bowl 16 years ago, and a lot of stuff, you know, went down in that particular at that particular time. But they've been awarded another one. Super Bowl, what is it, L? I don't know Roman numerals, B. It's the 2019 Super Bowl. And 2020 will be in South Florida, the Miami area, and L.A. The St. Louis Rams back in L.A. now. So, of course, they're going to get a new stadium and in 2021 have the Super Bowl there. The reason I'm bringing this up as not just a mention but a topic of conversation is because something that my former co-host likes to do, right? He likes to do this thing where he puts this scenario in one of these in like an either-or position where, you know, the Falcons would rather have a Super Bowl than playing one. And it's like, no, it doesn't work like that. It doesn't work like that. Before I get into that, though, let me talk about the selection itself. You know, it did bring, I talked about the Super Bowl being here 16 years ago, here being Atlanta 16 years ago. And some people brought some concerns to the table. Maybe one unanimous GM, I believe, brought some concerns to the table about what happened the last time. An ice storm happened, and Arthur Blank was put in a position, the owner of the Falcons, Arthur Blank, was put in a position to have to defend the city. Speaking of Arthur Blank, man, like, I was talking about Craig Sager earlier. He's going to receive the Jimmy V Perseverance Award at the ESPYs this year. And, Arthur Blank had, like, cancer for 2 weeks, it seemed like, a couple months ago. It was like, Arthur Blank has cancer. And then, like, 2 weeks later, it was like, yep, everything's a go, cancer-free, let's rock and roll. I'm like, damn, B. Like, it literally seemed like it was 2 weeks, I swear. I'm not even being hyperbolic. It seemed like it was 2 or 3 weeks from the time the news was kind of given to the public to the time he was like, yep, I'm all good to go. Must be nice to have money, man, that much of it. But anyway, Arthur Blank, you know, went into defense mode about this great city of Atlanta. And he says, quote, I reminded him, speaking of the owner that didn't want his name to be known. What the hell is the word I'm looking for? God, I can't believe I'm brain farting this bad. Anyway, he says, I reminded him that was 16 years ago, and the weather in Atlanta, due to climate changes, look at Arthur Blank, it's changed. So it's beautiful now. We don't think that will be an issue. I understand that was one in 100 years kind of freak stuff, end quote. Yeah, just because he said that. I don't even believe in, like, jinxing and all that, but yeah, dude. I think he just did it, man. Arthur Blank, he just made sure that it was gonna damn be an ice storm that year. I'm so mad that I can't think of that word, man. It's on, you know why? Because the word unanimous is on my brain, and I can't think of what word I'm trying to use, and that's like terrible. Like, I almost, like, literally, I almost hate myself right now. Anonymity, I don't know, whatever. So anyway, back to my partner, my player partner. One Rob Calloway, former co-host with me on the Sports Kings. He does this thing where it's like, you know, he's a Falcons fan. And he's like, oh, the Falcons would rather have a Super Bowl than be in one. And I've constantly told him no. Yesterday he put a post up on, I don't know if it was Instagram, and it just went to Facebook. But I think he's at Rob Calloway 3, if you guys want to follow him. He put a sign up that said host or hoist. And it doesn't work like that. You know, it's not like because you've done one, you don't do the other. There's plenty of teams. I thought about it last night after I saw his post. There's plenty of teams that have never played in the Super Bowl or never won a Super Bowl that host Super Bowls. Minnesota, Detroit, Atlanta being another one, Jacksonville, You know what I mean? All these teams hold Super Bowls before, but they've never won one. And as I thought about it to myself, I was like, they're teams that I see, they're teams that have won, right, that will probably never host one. Pittsburgh, Green Bay, New England will probably never host a Super Bowl. Because I've heard, like, Green Bay is like, or not Green Bay, New England is like Green Bay. The stadium is, like, in a neighborhood on some one-way, one-out, one-way-out thing. It's like a nightmare, and there's really nothing else around there type stuff. So, yeah, you know, I don't think weather's a factor after we've seen them host the Super Bowl and barely escape a winter storm in New York. I've heard a lot of people say that the Super Bowl in Indianapolis was awesome. I don't know, was Minnesota going to have one or they already had one? I can't remember. But even Minnesota's got a new stadium, so they get a Super Bowl. That's how it works. So why not Atlanta? And here's the thing. There's a couple of years in between now and the Super Bowl. So to kind of intimate that the Falcons aren't trying to go to the Super Bowl, you know, that's a foul. I mean, that doesn't really jive, man. Like, you can be both. Their teams, this is the 49ers, the Cowboys, they've won Super Bowls and they've hosted Super Bowls. You know what I mean? So it's there to be done. They're teams that I think will never do either. The Cleveland Browns will probably never host a Super Bowl. And more likely never win one. The Buffalo Bills, don't see it happening. The Detroit Lions, don't see it happening, right? Or, sorry, Detroit just hosted one, I'm sorry. But I'm talking teams that have never won and will never host. Who else? The Titans, there's nothing to do in no damn Nashville. Why would you do a Super Bowl in Tennessee? I was just there last week. I went to school up there. Nah. You know what I mean? There's certain teams that just won't. And there are certain teams that do because of where they're located. And they hold Super Bowls and haven't been to one. The Houston Texans. You know what I mean? Like, it shouldn't just be boiled down. As a fan, I don't think you should just boil it down to that. You know what I mean? And the last thing I want to talk about before I get up out of here is baseball great Tony Gwynn. One of the best hitters in baseball history. Tony Gwynn's been dead for 2 years now. I think it was 2 years yesterday. He's been dead. He died from a complication to a condition that is perceived, a cancer that he obtained from his 30-year addiction to smokeless tobacco, otherwise known as dip. Like, I've known dudes, I remember going to college, man, with dudes, white dudes who dipped. You put that stuff in their lip or whatever. And I used to be like, man, what the hell? I remember I asked this white dude named McBride. Man, what the hell does it taste like? And he was like, it tastes like dirt. And I was like, well, why you put it in your mouth? Like, you know, why don't you just go put some dirt in your mouth? And, like, dudes would be about to fight over, like, their last quote-unquote pinch in like, the can. They'd, like, be sitting there, like, popping the can with their fingers. And I couldn't understand, but he told me, like, it gives you a certain rush. I guess where you put it at, it goes right into the bloodstream. And, like, dudes would be showing off they lip, how, like, it'd be like a hole starting to form in the inside of their lip. Like, the most gross thing ever in history. But they ain't care. It was worth it. I bring all that up to say this about Tony Gwynn, man. His family is filing a wrongful death lawsuit against the tobacco industry. They filed it on Monday in San Diego Superior Court, and they allege negligence, product liability, excuse me, and fraud. And while all these things may be viable, I guess, it's really hard for me to see the validity in a lawsuit and what you hope to gain from it. You know what I mean? Because, like, yeah, for 30 years, this dude did this all the way back to his, you know, freshman year at 17 years old at San Diego State, where, you know, conversely, he ended up coaching at as well. Now, the warnings on the cans haven't been around that long, but I think the first one appeared in, like, 89. You know, that along with the fact that, like, Tony Gwynn has had a couple of surgeries to remove growths from that part of his mouth where he put the, you know, that part of his jaw or whatever, where he put the dip at, to the point his wife tells a story, or his wife telling a story about how immediately after he had this surgery to remove this growth from his jaw, the first thing he did when he got in the car is put a dip in. And she's like, dude, the wound or whatever hasn't even healed yet. He didn't care. You know what I mean? He didn't care. I heard him talking about it, you know, after, because it had to happen three times, basically. Three times they went in and removed the growth. He was like, I know it's right. And like, there was no definite medical proof that it was caused by this rare form of cancer, was caused by the dip. But he kind of just arrived at the conclusion, like, look, yeah, is what other reason would there be? It's right in the space where I put the dip. He says this, but he continued to do it, not understand the you know, the whole addiction angle to it. But even with that being the case, it makes it real hard for me to think that there's something to gain from suing the tobacco company at this point in 2016, where information is readily available. And now, just obviously, this is 2014 when he ended up succumbing to the what did it say? It was cancer of the salivary gland, and what he ended up dying from was respiratory failure. That was, you know, a subsidiary. It was actually caused by the disease. I mean, he had it bad. This article I'm looking at from Yahoo Sports talks about him going to sleep with a dip in his mouth. He talked about feeling like a junkie. In the middle of the night, everybody sleep. He gets up and goes down to the convenience store, and the lady behind the counter is like feeling bad for him. Like, dude, you here for that at this time in the morning? And didn't even really want to sell. He could tell she didn't even want to sell it to him. Like, I don't know really who you hold accountable for that. Like, as his family, maybe it's guilt that's telling them to file this lawsuit because they didn't do enough. Because even in the story where his wife talks about him taking the dip immediately after coming out of surgery, basically, all she said, all that was her only comment to him, was that your wound didn't even close yet or even healed yet, or the whatever from the surgery isn't even healed yet. That was it. And, you know, it's Tony Gwynn. You know, he's beloved by everybody. You know, he never done nobody wrong as far as what anybody knows. You know, as far as after becoming a public figure, I've never heard anything bad mentioned about Tony Gwynn. But even in that sense, at some point, man, when somebody has the problem, and I haven't dealt with someone who has that type of addiction or problem, anything like that, but it would seem that caring about him means seeking help, not just saying to him, don't do that anymore, because it's apparent that the problem is bigger than him, to the point where even three times, them having to go and cut off a part of your face, B, if you saw Tony Gwynn's face before he died, it actually looked like they were just cutting parts. At a certain point, they were cutting his face, not just the growth. His face was missing. Not like missing, but it was deformed. He couldn't speak properly. He looked like a stroke victim, but he hadn't had a stroke. Like once it gets to that point, and no one's truly addressing the problem outside of you shouldn't do that, there's a little bit of blame to go around to everyone. And I think the least of the blame, to be honest, in my opinion, the least of the blame is to the tobacco industry. As kind of as skeevy as I think that part of our society is, in this case, I don't think they're really holding the bag for his death. Part of the reason for the lawsuit, by the way, is that they're saying that he was given free samples in a marketing scheme that used contract employees to reach out to athletes while he was in college. And they're using that to say that they use him as advertising. And that, you know, that may fly. But at what point is it just like, you know how many people in this country die from overdoses to prescription drugs? They're saying that's what Prince died from, prescription drugs. But people ain't running out, not to my knowledge. People ain't running out filing lawsuits against Big Pharma. You know, because people are dying from oxycodone and opioid overdoses and things of that nature. This to me, it sounds like guilt, man. You know what I mean? And that's tough. You know, when someone you love and someone who's beloved by many, you know, makes a decision, and that decision ends up costing them their life. But, you know, I'll say this. This is my take on anything of this nature. Everybody has a right, man, to decide, you know, how they live their life and what they're willing to risk their life for. You know, for some people, it's their kids and their family. For Tony Gwynn, obviously, it was he was willing to risk his life and leaving his family at the age of 54 for that whatever feeling he got from that dip. And that's real, and that's hard for people to accept. But yeah, your dad, your husband, your brother, your uncle, whoever Tony Gwynn was to you, that's a choice that he made. And yeah, like I said before, we can go with the addiction side of things. But there are places to go seek help. And the same way I talk about Johnny Manziel, people who have the resources to address their addiction issues and still continue down that road, even though they see the way it's affecting the people that care about them and love them. That's just a decision that they're making at some point, man. It becomes a decision. You know, because even in his addiction, people were still allowing him, because he used the fact that he was such a hard worker and such an avid worker at the sport of baseball, and he associated that with the dip. So as long as he was doing that, he was dipping. Well, here's the thing, man. You shouldn't be coaching baseball then. As good as you are, and a lot of people say he's one of the top whatever five hitters of all time in the league, maybe you shouldn't be doing that. Maybe you shouldn't be an alcoholic working as a bartender. If that's the thing that you associate with your addiction, man, maybe that's the thing that you shouldn't be doing, no matter how good you are at it. Now, I mentioned Johnny Manziel, and I don't really like to mention that dude in this on my show, man, because I think he's not even a sports figure anymore. That's done. They got pictures of him now. He's looking all skinny, and he's like a dope fiend. He looks like a true dope fiend. And while everybody was trying to like mask it and tell us that lie about, oh, Johnny's got an alcohol problem. No, I know what I saw. I saw the pictures of him in the bathroom, a candid picture, not something that was being posed for. Like somebody like sneaking a picture of him with rolled up dollar bills, man. I know. Not dollar bills. I think it was like $100 bills. What the move is with that. And now everybody wants to act concerned. His friends. I've long since maintained my position that Johnny Manziel ain't got no damn friends. Because these are the same people, man, who let people take these pictures of him and let him pose for these pictures in the club with champagne, the dude with the drinking problem. The same people who he's in the bathroom with doing blow. Allegedly, I guess. Yeah, whatever. Yeah, I would maintain that he didn't have friends. You know what I mean? But now, everybody won't be concerned now when it's almost too late. Look, man, again, if this is a choice that this dude is making, a dude with the resources to remedy the thing that is wrong with him, if he's coping with whatever emotionally, there are resources there, and he has the financial means to seek those things out. The reason I can't feel sorry for him, because there's people who's going through life that don't have access to those resources, that are going through the same problems as he had. We don't feel sorry for them. We look at them as the underbelly of society, right? Nah, man. And like, yo, people are scared for Johnny Manziel's life. Not me, man. If I turn on my TV tomorrow, man, and they find Johnny Manziel in his apartment overdose, like, you know who ain't gonna be surprised? Me. I'm not hoping it happens, and like, I can't believe how stupid I am saying that. Like, even if I was hoping it happened to him, like, I don't have those kind of powers. I don't know anyone. I don't know anyone who does. You know, you. I hope this happens to Johnny Manziel, and then it happens. So that's one of the stupid things people say. Well, I don't wish nothing bad on him. Well, even if you did, it wouldn't make it happen. You know what I mean? But, like, I wouldn't care is what I'm saying. Because, you know, certain stories, man, certain stories end a certain way, man. Whitney Houston, that story was going to end that way. Michael Jackson need horse tranquilizers to go to sleep. That story was probably going to end that way. I don't know the whole details about the Prince situation. I know they said they found, like, there was something that said they found prescription drugs on him, and the autopsy hadn't been done at that time. I don't know if it's been done now to find out if he had the stuff in the system. I don't know. But whatever. Certain stories in certain ways. Now, you may get a surprise ending in some situations, but you shouldn't be surprised. Like, that should be the surprise. Like, if Johnny Manziel next year came back clean and sober and, you know, all, you know, wholesome and, you know, starting for, I don't know, some team that needs a quarterback, maybe the Jets or somebody, and he leads them to the playoffs, that's a surprise. You know, and he's not dead. Maybe that's the biggest surprise, if he just isn't dead next year. You know what I mean? But anything else, come on, man. We can't be that. We can't continue to do that. That that fake emotional outrage over things that seem to be inevitable once they happen. Nah, I'm good. I'm good. Let me clean up the notes here and make sure I got everything off the plate real quick. I didn't mention this the other day, that Vic Beasley, from my Falcons fans out there, is going to be moving to Sam linebacker, kind of the way Bruce Irvin did. We'll see how that works out. You pick a dude, what, 7th, 8th overall, move him outside linebacker. Like, the Bruce Irvin thing was a little bit different because they didn't know how he was going to get on the field. They had so many pass rushers. They didn't know how he was going to get on the field, so they needed to stand him up. And I remember reading the article that Bruce Irvin said that he felt as though that saved his career. You know what I mean? And kept him from just rotting away on the bench. Yeah, in this situation, the Falcons ain't got no damn pass rushers. I'm hearing they're supposed to be bringing in Dwight Freeney for a tryout. You know, that's Dwight Freeney's the hot potato, man. For those people who will never hear me talk about the hot potato, he's the dude that has a name and can produce, well, and has produced recently. But at some point, man, somebody gonna catch that brick. That one team that says, you know, he might got another year in him, you know, and he doesn't. I don't know if he doesn't, but that happens. You know what I mean? You're going to catch that brick. The team that understands it a lot seems to be the Denver Broncos. They got what they needed to get from DeMarcus Ware, and then was like, look, if you want to stay around here, yeah, you got to give us some of this money back, B, because we don't know what's going to happen with you. And now he's back bossing them again, back then flared up again. Yeah. You can't let old players fool you, man, especially in the NFL. It's a young man's game. Don't let that happen. Dwight Freeney played well last year for that Cardinals squad. But, yeah, to keep betting on it, that turns you into the fool. And finally, the Chris Bosh situation in Miami. It's crazy. And I know I just got through talking about people willing to risk their lives for certain things. I think this is a little bit different because it's a more public thing. You don't want, if it's a possibility that a dude might die on the court, if you're the Miami Heat, you don't want that. You know, you don't want that in your bag. You know what I mean? Especially when you had a way to prevent it. Chris Bosh wants to play. You know, he's been dealing with the blood clots, right? But here's what I wanted to bring up as it relates to this. Bo Kimble, kind of pleading. Bo Kimble played with Hank Gathers and Loyola Marymount back in the day. If you're too young to remember, Google it. Hank Gathers died on the basketball court. He had a heart problem. Bo Kimble is kind of projecting his experience with Hank Gathers onto Chris Bosh without any medical information, saying Chris Bosh needs to retire. You know, you don't need to be like Hank and all this kind of stuff. And I'm like, my man, slow down. Just because somebody asks you a question, man, it's okay to be like, I don't know. I don't know what the situation is because you're not a part of that team. You're not even a part of basketball, B. Like, that's the kind of stuff. Like, if I'm Chris Bosh, like, well, if I'm me, not because Chris Bosh seems to be a more level-headed dude than I am, I'd be like, man, shut your ass up, man. Stay out my business, man. You don't know me like that. And now, you know, Bo Kimble's, I saw him on TV today, as a matter of fact, off of a TMZ comment. He's on, like, Outside the Lines or something. He's on something on ESPN today. Yeah, that to me, that ain't cool, man. You know, I grew up in a time where as a man, you mind your business, man. Like, that ain't even in, like, your man or nothing. You just, your dude died. Yeah, Hank Gathers died, unfortunately. And here's the thing about that, too. Hank Gathers, if that happened to him today, he probably would live. Because now, because of that happening to him, even like at AAU and in rec league ball, you have to have a defibrillator on hand. They didn't have one of those when Hank Gathers was playing ball. So, inevitably, he took his last breath on the basketball court. So it's different. It's a different situation, even with the limited knowledge that I have. It's different. You know what I mean? That's going to do it, man. We're on over this hump, man. Okay. Yeah, buddy. We're over this hump, man. Appreciate you guys for joining me, man, and hanging out. I'm going to catch some of this basketball. I got some work to do. Come back on Friday. Do it again, man. Hopefully I have a guest. Hopefully my big guest that flaked on me today. Hopefully I can work on that and get that popping for my Friday show. If not, man, it's just going to be me and my mic. One Mic with Big Mike. Make sure you guys check out the website, www.onemicwithbigmike.com. Also, check me out. Sign up for your free Spreaker account, man, and search for my show, One Mic with Big Mike. Follow me on Spreaker. Follow me on Twitter. Follow me on Instagram, all those things. And don't forget, if you got the TuneIn app or the iTunes app on your phone, or even if you want to check it out on YouTube, every episode of the show, every episode that I do is available there, as well as on Spreaker and on my website, man. So that's going to do it. I'm going to catch some basketball, get some work done. Got to make some money, man. And I'll holler at you dudes on you dudes and you dudettes, ladies and gentlemen, on Friday. Have a good one.